inviting me. And so as he indicated, I'm going to talk about the BTK Centers of Excellence. And a large part of what they do is related to training, obviously. They're largely focused on research, but training is an integral part of those efforts. And so given the audience, I thought I would just sort of give an overview of all the different centers and different components, because I don't think everyone is necessarily familiar with BTK. Given that you've got folks from across the pond, they may not know of all the different centers. And so what you see here is a list of all of the different centers that are actually funded by the National Institutes of Health as part of the BTK Centers of Excellence. I've included BioPetty there. It's not formally a center of excellence, but it is one of the integral centers in the BTK effort. And so you can see they're sort of covering a lot of different topics just from the titles of these different centers. But broadly speaking, a lot of them cover different aspects of biological components like genomics and different types of omics. You have large groups covering mHealth, so mobile health. You have other groups that are working more on the metadata side, so which is agnostic to the specific biomedical domain. You have people working on imaging. You have all sorts of different areas. And so just to sort of highlight some of them, I guess it's actually a little small to read. But for instance, BDDS, which is the big data for discovery science, which is out of USC, which some of you are associated with, is one site. And for instance, we have CPCP, which is the Center for Computational, for Predictive Computational Phenotyping, which is out of Wisconsin Madison. So you've got a lot of different focus groups, or focuses, for data science going on. Some of these people are focusing more on machine learning strategies. Others are focusing on data integration challenges. It really does cover a full gamut of research and subsequently the training. So if you look at the training activities that are actually ongoing through these BTK centers, they actually are pretty broad. And so a lot of them have summer programs or short courses in datathons. So one example is the MD2K group, which is a mobile health group that's out of the University of Memphis. And they host a mHealth Institute every summer, which is an invitation-only program for people with PhDs or MDs. And they basically invite you for 1 week to work on mHealth projects and get some training in mHealth issues. Other programs like the BDTK Links program of Mount Sinai has a program for it's about 10 weeks where they take undergraduates in for the entire summer and they give them a summer research internship. So you have a lot of different activities going on in terms of those types of summer programs. A lot of the other centers have short courses, so for instance, Center for Causal Discovery, which is at the University of Pittsburgh, has a 3.5-day workshop every, I believe, summer, where they basically go over causal discovery and causal graphs. The centers have also been hosting datathons, where people are challenged to sort of work on different data sets, come up with different things, each sort of akin to hackathons. And so these have actually been relatively popular activities. Sort of second type of category of training activities which are going on through the BTK centers, kind of the lecture series and online resource developments. And this has actually also been somewhat interesting because they've all taken different approaches in this regard. So lecture series, as you can imagine, are typically focused around the various centers' activities. So for instance, again, the Center for Causal Discovery has a distinguished lecture series focusing on causality, I should say. Others have developed MOOCs. So there are various online resources in terms of MOOCs for looking at data from the LINCS centers, for instance. And so a lot of bioinformatics and machine learning techniques are introduced through that course, and I believe that's actually on Coursera, for instance. Obviously, they have a lot of undergraduate and graduate course development, both around biomedical informatics and data science initiatives. So in this particular case, they're looking at typically course development in either specific biomedical informatics programs or biostats programs. sort of, again, covered a lot of different graduate and undergraduate programs. And then finally, we have a lot of diversity initiatives that are ongoing through these B2K centers. So I've already alluded to the fact that a lot of the centers are involved with undergraduate trainings. They have summer internships and such. And they sort of draw from a large diversity of universities and areas. So a lot of them are, for instance, coupled with historically black colleges and universities, HBCUs. Others are reaching out even further. I think some of the programs, for instance, have undergraduate students they take from the University of Puerto Rico. So it's a very broad engagement of undergraduates. And all of this is just to get them engaged in data science. So when you look at it in total, the B2K centers actually support a very broad audience of trainees. So it starts with, obviously, the traditional postdocs, the graduate students and undergraduates. Some programs are even reaching out to high school students to engage them early on in data science. But they also have a lot of activities that are focused more on the faculty and the research staff, too. So it's not a single type of training that's really going on through these B2K centers. It's a much wider spectrum of individuals that they're trying to reach. So what are the challenges? Well, there's as you can imagine, there are a lot of different challenges that are going on through the B2K centers. One is, as they've looked at the problem of trying to train these individuals, they've realized a couple different things. One is that, first of all, there are no best practices that are clearly out there for training in data science, or at least none that they can reference, largely because they have different audiences and different levels that they're trying to reach. So if you look at, again, sort of just drawing from what I've described, you have a lot of different types of individuals that require training in data science, or want training in data science. These may be MDs, these may be computer scientists, or others who may or may not have a biomedical background, who may or may not have a computational background, and even if they do have a computational background, they may not necessarily have other elements they need, like a statistical background, in order to appreciate different aspects of data science. You also have this challenge of going from trying to engage people at the undergraduate or even younger ages, all the way up to more senior researchers who are trying to get engaged in data science within their own research. And so a lot of these centers are sort of thinking, well, what are the best practices out there? How do we actually train these individuals? So somewhat related to that is basically the fact that there's really no set of use cases out there that epitomize how biomedical data science is both research and applied. So as you think about the training activities, or at least as these centers have done so, they've realized two things. One is that there are people who want to learn how to use data science as a tool, but are not necessarily engaged in data science research itself. So there's a fundamental difference between being able to develop new techniques within data science versus using the techniques of data science. So this is sort of the difference between the research and the applied, and what we're seeing is they're both needed. Training in both of them are needed, but there's also a lot of confusion a lot of times between programs as to what really the focus should be. So one thing I think that the centers are looking for are, like I said, these use cases. So what are the different cases and scenarios where this is being taught? And I think the analogy here is if you think about how math is taught, right? If you think about math as a fundamental tool, you learn math without necessarily specifics to domains, but if you look at a math textbook, you're typically chapters towards the end of the math textbook, which are very domain specific. And they show how the math is applied in a given set of scenarios. So going along with this thought, though, there is also this question about whether there's a need to define a minimal baseline curriculum and set of skills for biomedical data science. This is, I've heard both sides of the debate now, which is there is supposedly a fixed curriculum that really does need to be taught, and I've also heard the argument that no, there really isn't one. This is an interesting question, and I think this is a question that the data science community needs to look at quite closely. Again, this is sort of an open-ended question. No one necessarily has an answer. I think most of us would feel that there is at least a minimal set of skills. Whether there's a minimum curriculum, there probably is. But again, what that is again, open for debate. And then finally, and this is coming from having just completed a training program renewal, which is there's a really big problem in trying to track the outcomes for these trainees, right? And the question is a little more interesting, I think, in the data science space, which is what is it we see as success as training someone in data science? It's an open-ended question as well, right? Which is sort of say, do we want data scientists to come out, or do we want people who are able to use data science? What is the level of success that we imagine for these trainees, and what's been the educational impact of all of this? So these are some open questions. Again, we don't necessarily have the answers, but maybe collectively we can brainstorm about these. But when you think about it, and collectively look at all of this, these are all four questions or four challenges here are actually interrelated. Because without sort of knowing the outcomes, we can't really identify what the best practices should be. So without knowing what best practices there are, we don't know what the use cases might be. And then if we have use cases, we can probably identify what these curriculum and these other different skills might also be as well. So they're all interrelated challenges for which we certainly need to think about. But the other part of this is what standards and resources can we leverage to address these challenges? I think this is actually one place where the people in this room actually have the expertise to sort of reach out and sort of say, well, there are standards and resources for a lot of these things. The problem is that there's often a sort of bifurcation, if you will, between the resources as they are described versus the resources as we want to use them. The reason why I say that is a lot of the resources that we end up indexing or finding out about are very specific. They're very, I don't want to say they're niche, but they are often talk about how to use tools. So a given center may develop a certain tool and they have all these videos or all these instructions on how to use a specific tool. But on the other hand, they don't necessarily talk about what are the general concepts behind data science. So there's that level of abstraction that is sometimes necessary in order to get reuse out of the material. And so this is sort of an open-ended question. Again, the question of standards and resources, and I think this also goes to what is the metadata that we actually have to describe all this. And so the previous talk, for instance, obviously the work that's also been done through Erudite, are sort of getting to the metadata that surrounds a lot of the training materials out there, but I don't necessarily think that people are tagging their stuff as well as they could. And I think that's a big challenge. So one of the questions for this group is how do we incentivize people to actually tag their stuff, to put the metadata that we want around the training information so it can be used. And I think the other sort of question and is really how do we actually connect these efforts with other national and international programs? So BD2K is obviously just one aspect of data science training. But again, the NIH has a large interest, at least from what I understand, of engaging data science across the spectrum. And so if you look, for instance, at CTSA, so again, for those who aren't familiar with National Institutes of Health, CTSAs are the Clinical Translational Science Awards, which are a very large program that's supported by NIH. There's, I think, 64 hubs across the US. These are relatively largely funded centers. And one component of these CTSAs is informatics. And recently, there was a call for a coordinating center in informatics for these CTSAs. And part of it, there was a call for the metadata standards behind education for informatics and data science within the CTSAs. So this is actually an interesting situation where the CTSAs and are sort of saying, we want to know what's out there for data science training. Now, their particular focus on data science training is a little different from what you might consider in this room, but in their perspective, the question is, how do we train physicians to be able to use data science? And so they're looking for people to sort of fill that gap, which is, and obviously the education is only one part of that particular coordinating center, but they're looking for people to fill the gap and saying, what's out there? What can we index? How do we make these resources available to the informatics programs through the CTSAs? And vice versa, which is the CTSAs are also generating materials. They're generating content and training materials for their own sites. What are the standards and the metadata that they should be using in order to actually put this information out there for the other groups to use and beyond the CTSA? So this is actually an interesting time. The people in this room have an ability to influence how the CTSAs within the NIH are actually going to incorporate training materials for data science. And it will actually have the potential for really broad dissemination because of the CTSA's scope. So rather than sort of throw all these different slides and questions out there to you, I thought I would just sort of open this up more to a general discussion. So
it's interesting that there, you kind of alluded to this before, and I did write this down on a sticky note, that best practices is sort of a moving target, depending on the audience. If you're looking at like really young high school students or students who are in their primary education, that's completely different from what you want to get across to them than somebody who's a established, you know, research faculty member. And that, what do you want to get out of them? You want some familiarity on one end, you want maybe that same familiarity at the other end, but you want some level of proficiency as well. And I think Lisa had kind of touched on, you know, how you evaluate the success of what's coming out of these things as something that is an absolute must do, it's a must do at every level of that spectrum.
Right.
In order to understand you're hitting the right target.
Right, and it's sort of the fact that it is a spectrum and different levels of training, and that is, I think, a bit of a confounding factor for a lot of people who are trying to do the training, because they don't because depending on what they're trying, who they're trying to reach out to, they don't necessarily know what the best practices are applicable or not, right? Well, first of all, honestly, I don't think I necessarily list the best practices to begin with.
Well, again, you know, I think you touched on that as well. There's probably people who are very dogmatic. There is some like core canonical thing that you want to get across to people they should be competent in. On the other hand, you know, the trainer activity might need to be tailored itself. I mean, train the trainer to train the trainees at the appropriate level. You may have some more experience with this than I do.
Yeah, I mean, we do have the train the trainer, train the trainer, trainer.
Yeah.
As well, where we train the instructors for the training. It does have to be tailored towards a certain group of people, and I think that's a good thing about Elixir, is that we don't do a one size fits all. We will tailor to different groups of people, but overall the impact and quality needs to be assessed in the same way.
I think that's the question, which is sort of where it becomes difficult is a lot of times, at least with training programs in data science, we're also sort of, there's this pushback for generalization. Right? What is the common thread of data science or things like that? And even within NIH, I know that there's a debate about this, the training aspects, which is, do we want general data science for biomedicine, or do we want domain-specific data science, which might be for, let's say, cancer, one might be for, I don't know, lung or something like that. And so I think this is I don't think the community has necessarily established what's effective yet, whether it needs to be domain-specific or there is a general thread, or both.
It's interesting. I've got a high schooler who's or a rather big part of it. I've got one of those too. But I have a girl who's a daughter who's at the University of California, Santa Cruz, and she's taking a basically statistics, intro statistics course. And so she's texting me about, Dad, what is the critical T value? What does that mean? And so it's kind of interesting because it's you don't really start to get into statistics, formal training until you're like in your middle of your undergraduate collegiate years. And I don't know if my younger daughter, who's really just struggling with algebra, would be able to conceive what the critical values in the tail of the T distribution are. So, it's sort of like there's like levels of exposure, which you don't want to make it too soon, but you don't want to make it too late. There's these sweet spots. I'm not quite sure how you train your trainers to train them appropriately, but there must be, with enough repetition, enough exposure to different audiences, we must get some sort of insight into that. Mm-hmm.
So another question, and this goes to the question about use cases that I have, is what are there actually good examples of data science training, of successes that we would all sort of gravitate towards as models?
So I was just going to ask a question which sort of leads us to the
Sure.
So there's more comment actually. So earlier today I mentioned that we've been talking to the co-debitor RBA people who have already set up the data science summer school. And I think the first one around last summer. So the way they envisaged their program working was that they had a generic data science summer school, and then they would invite experts in to create add-on modules, advanced modules that were domain-specific. Mm-hmm. So hence they contacted us and started to initiate dialogue about a bioinformatics flavor data science and other people doing different domains. So we have a kind of modular approach to how this works. But in terms of what, they've obviously worked out their own curriculum for the generic stuff, but that might not be the same as what you might come up with. Who knows? But they've certainly got a program that's they certainly ran it last year, they're running it again this year, they're applying funding to run it again the year after, and I guess they're going to learn a lot as they go along. Which is why I said it might be worth contacting them and seeing what they do.
Carol?
Yeah, well, when we talked this morning about producing people who are actually going to be the theoretical quantitative data science people, my thought after looking at a lot of these people, especially in career development, because that's what I do, is that there are certain threads. I mean, there are certain things that in order to be competitive and to have grant support and to be actually doing this, there are certain threads and skills. Now, they're strong in different areas, but there is a baseline of stuff that if you're going out to hire someone to do methodology development, you're going to expect these people to have. The variety in what a biomedical scientist needs is what is extremely varied, both by the university, what the background is of the people coming in, and by the kinds of degrees that each university might have. And the applications, I think those are the ones that it's very hard to try to decide, what might be, what you might expect to be putting into that, because in our universities we have schools, a lot of schools, medical schools, and so they're going to have, some of the physician scientist training, they're going to have, the biomedicals, the applications, You're going to go over to a school that doesn't have a medical school, but is, you know, like really into arts and sciences. So things that they're going to be looking at, they're probably not going to do a lot of the medical applications because they're going to be DNA repair people. And then you're going to go to some place that's like a land grant school that's got a school of agriculture, and they're going to have a school of biostatistics, and they're going to have a school of engineering, and you know. So I'm not sure that I think we could probably look at things for like PhD. If you get a PhD in data science, maybe there are certain things that you would expect this person to be trained in. What do you think?
Well, I was going to defer to Gully, if I can remember that.
Okay, Tom.
Well, I mean, I just noticed that in the list of the T15, T32 UTK funded centers, there are 16 separate people who are funded to do UTK data science training.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys, they compete against one another to try and get things done, right? So one would imagine that they have syllabi and that they have a framework for teaching the aspects of data science. Because I noticed that one of them is Harvard, is the School of Public Health, and their center, or the health center data science, as opposed to other people, right? So it strikes me that trying to learn from that, from their curriculum, is at least a very good starting place. And I don't know whether or not I don't know if they're more advanced than PhD or their PhD level.
Your PhD level.
Yeah, for all of us at the PhD level. It's very interesting you bring that up, because when we've got the last BDTK has an all hands meeting, just like Elixir does, where all the principal investigators come together. We had this one last November. And we actually hosted a dinner with the T32 awardees. Several of the PIs came. It wasn't all 16 of them, it was a number of them. And I found the conversations very interesting, because we kind of posed to them, you know, what were some of the successes and failures in putting together curricula for data science training at their institution. And they're all taking kind of a slightly different, you know, kind of stab at it. But it was very interesting to kind of compare notes and get their thoughts on it. But you're absolutely right. They've got different curricula. They're looking at different things. Some people have, you know, full-on courses. Some are just kind of like research-driven PhD tracks that you can do. So they're doing a computer science PhD, but you have a data science kind of thrust to it. There are various other things which are going on, and they could be a resource for providing guidance on what has been successful or otherwise.
So do the T32s and the T15s have, I mean, there must be overlap and convergence in some parts of their curricula.
There are some
overlaps. Yeah. It kind of, well, like any kind of graduate training, the programs reflect some departments of the faculty.
Yeah.
To a great extent. And so that, I mean, that, you know, that is just kind of what you get all the time. And it's not only how the courses are quite taught, but it's the research emphasis, because at the end they're going to have to do a research thesis. And the research thesis is going to have, you know, even if they have a quantitative background, they're going to have to take enough of the domain to understand that what their, you know, the quantitative aspect of this makes sense biologically, so, to some extent.
So it'd be interesting to sort of synthesize out of all of these different curricula what the themes are of the coursework.
I think now that they've got a couple of years of experience under their belt, they're probably now positioned to be able to do that compare and contrast exercise.
I think it's a fascinating exercise to do that.
Yeah.
So we've been kind of doing that, like by collecting all these materials and all these MOOCs, and you can see all these different trends of people who come from statisticians, and there are kind of programming R. And remember the Johns Hopkins people, for example, they have this R data science program. But it's really genetics. I mean, R is genetics. And that's very different from the guys in the computer science and the big data world and the kind of how to do large scale things. And they're using some of the common techniques. I mean, they use some kind of machine learning or statistical methods, but they're really coming from quite different places.
Exactly.
We're collecting all these materials to maybe put some order. I mean, there's some structure already in data science you have to do that. Yeah. I mean, it's one of the steps we're talking about here. Like the data collection, the cleaning, the statistical analysis, visualization, exploration. There's some major kind of themes, but then when you go to the techniques and how large they're going to scale and so on, I think it's quite varied.
That's why the analogy to math, I think, is somewhat useful, because there's sort of that commonality, but it also is used in different ways.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you brought up Harvard, and Harvard is, I think, the School of Public Health. So, you know, you're going to get an aspect of population scientists, biostatistics. Yeah. Whereas, you know, if you're coming from, MIT or something like that, you're going to get.
So I'd like to kind of transition this, because this is a great discussion. I don't mean to kind of cut it off, but I want to make sure that we kind of stick to our schedule. I know that both Alex and Jeff have to go at some point this afternoon, and I want to.